वेलकम बैक अनंत सर. दो मीर అన్నిట్లల్లో పార్టిసిపేట్ చేస్తున్నారు.
సార్ ఇస్ ఆల్వేస్ అదు ఎట్లుందంటే సార్ అన్ని పార్టిసిపేట్ కూడా చేస్తారు కదా. సో నేను అసలు రిటైర్ అయినా సార్ రోజు వచ్చినట్టు వచ్చినారు అనుకుంటున్నా.
అంటే మీరు ఏదో డిపార్ట్మెంట్ లో లేరు అని అనిపించట్లేదు.
అనిపించట్లేదు అది.
ఆఫ్ కోర్స్ సార్ బిఎస్ఆర్ ఫ్యాకల్టీ
అంటే మెటల్ సార్ పార్ట్ ఆఫ్ ద డిపార్ట్మెంట్ అంటే
సార్ అన్ని ప్రోగ్రామ్స్ అటెండ్ అవుతారు
పద్మశ్రీ అందరూ ఉంటే నిన్ననే లేట్ అయింది కదా మనం స్టార్ట్ చేస్తే
స్ట్రీమింగ్ స్టార్ట్ చేశాను
ఇంకా స్టార్ట్ చేద్దాం
స్టార్టింగ్ ప్రాసెస్ మీకు 5 నిమిషాలు తీసుకుంటుంది కదా 10 నిమిషాలు నిన్న సార్ కి 11:20 కి ఇచ్చాం మనం
అంటే నిన్న కొంచెం
స్టార్ట్ చేయొచ్చు మేడం 11 కి ఎవ్రీథింగ్ ఇస్ రెడీ
యాక్చువల్గా ఈ అంత ముందు
శ్రేయ కూడా వచ్చింది సునైన ఇస్ ఆల్సో దేర్ ఐ థింక్
సునైన
సార్ సరసిజ బిజీయా
actually I am at Hyderabad she is at Karimnagar
okay
but zoom la connect kavachu ga sir meedu undan telisi
anna sarasija kuda ikkadike vachindemo malli ellipoyinda
vachu vellindi kan nenu mar link nenaithe share cheyaledu
ayyo padmasri
padmasri chestuntadu sir padmasri aa university ke pettuntadu kada sir
సరసిజ వస్తే అన్ని మిస్టేక్స్ అన్ని పాయింట్ అవుట్ చేస్తా తర్వాత
మిమ్మల్ని పాయింట్ అవుట్ చేస్తా సార్
సార్ మంచిగా సార్ మీరు ఇంప్రూవ్ చేసుకోవచ్చు కదా అది అది కన్స్ట్రక్టివ్ క్రిటిసిజం సార్
కాదు కొన్ని యాడ్ చేసి కూడా చెప్తుంది
మెసేజ్ పెట్టినా కానీ సరసిజ ఇంత తొందర చూడదు మనలాగా
అది కూడా కరెక్ట్
మార్నింగ్ పెడితే ఈవినింగ్ చూసి అప్పుడు
మనలాగా అనకు సరిత మనలాగా అనకు ఎమ్మటే చూసేవాడి లిస్ట్ లో ఎవరంటే నేను పద్మశ్రీ ఎమ్మటెమ్మటే చూసే వాళ్ళలో
ఉంటాం
అంత తొందర చూడ
పద్మావతి
పద్మావతి కూడా
నేను
పద్మశ్రీ అసలు ఏంటి సార్ పక్కనే ఉంటది అన్నట్టు ఉంటాం అనమాట ఎప్పుడు
మంచిదే కదా అందరు ఒక్కలాగా ఉండరు కదా అట్లా
అంటే మా గ్రూప్ లో ఎక్కువ ఉన్నాయేమో
పద్మశ్రీ కూడా ఉంటాయి గ్రూప్ లెక్క
పద్మశ్రీ యాక్టివ్ సోషల్ మీడియాలో అది తెలుసు కదా అదే కాదు ఇవన్నిట్లో కూడా యాక్టివ్
భాస్కర్ సార్ కూడా జాయిన్ అయింది
గుడ్
మార్నింగ్ సార్
మార్నింగ్ సార్
సార్ అన్మ్యూట్ చేసుకోండి సార్
నేను అన్మ్యూట్
సార్ భాస్కర్ సార్ ఆ
చేసుకున్నాను
మార్నింగ్ సార్
అనంత లక్ష్మి మేడం గుడ్ మార్నింగ్
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్
ఏ సార్ ఇంత మంది ఉంటే అనంత లక్ష్మి మేడం
అసలు
అట్లా అంటే భాస్కర్ సార్ వచ్చినారు అన్నదే నేను
పెట్టుకోలేదు మేడం అన్ని
అట్లా కాదు మిగతా వాళ్ళు ఏమన్నారు మేడం
మళ్ళీ అది కరెక్ట్
మొన్న హెడ్ సార్ అడిగండి కదా అనంత లక్ష్మి మేడం కనపడుతున్నాను లక్ష్మి కనపడి అందరికి కనపడ్డట్టే
చెప్తాను కనిపిస్తే అందరికి కనపడ్డట్టు
అమ్మ ఇన్ఫినిట్ కనపడకూడదు కదా అంటే ఆటోమేటిక్ గా కనపడుతుందేమో
భాస్కర్ సార్
గుడ్
మార్నింగ్ సార్
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ ఫస్ట్ నీకే చెప్పేసాను సార్
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ భాస్కర్ సార్
నమస్కారం నమస్కారం మేడం
జిల్లా తక్కి డిఫరెంట్ చెప్పారు
సార్ మేడం మీ వీడియో పెట్టుకోలేదే గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ భవానీ మేడం
భవానీ మేడమా మేడం కనపడరు వినపడరు అనుకుంటా
మేడం అర్బస్ మిస్ మేడం భవానీ మేడం చెప్పారా
ఆ భవానీ మేడం కి చెప్పాను సో క్వశ్చన్ ఏర్ మేడం విల్
మేడం రెండు పెట్టుకోలేదు కనపడట్లే వినపడట్లే
ఆస్ టు అన్మ్యూట్ అన్నాను మరి మేడం మురళీధర్ కూడా
మురళీధర్ అంటే పెట్టిపోతాడు
మురళికి మురళికి ఒకటేసారి నాలుగైదు వెబినార్ నడతాండి నాలుగైదు పెట్టుకుంటాడు కదా
అన్ని ఫోటో పెట్టిపోతాడా
పెట్టిపోతాడు మల్టిపుల్ మల్టిపుల్ ఆయన మల్టిపుల్ టాలెంటెడ్ ఆయన
అనంత మేడం ఈ మురళి గానీ సోమేశ్వర్ గాని మనం వాళ్ళంతా సాఫ్ట్వేర్ ఎక్స్పర్ట్స్
వాళ్ళు అనంత మేడం నేను తక్కువ ఎస్టిమేట్ చేస్తాను మీరు
నేను అట్లానే యంగ్స్టర్స్ అంటున్నా మేడం
స్పెషల్ ఇన్విటేషన్
అయ్యో ఏం లేదు మేడం మాకు కూడా ఇవాళ ఒక వెబినార్ ఉంది సాయంత్రం
సాయంత్రం కదా
అదే 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 హలో మేడం
ఇంకా స్టార్ట్ చేద్దాం
క్లాస్
టైం అయింది మేడం స్టార్ట్ చేయండి
1:34
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ ఆల్ స్టార్ట్ చేయండి 11 అయిపోయింది
బస్రీ మేడం
సార్ గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ సార్
గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ అయితే ఒక 1 or 2 times వాళ్ళను ఒక 2 questions అడిగినప్పుడు వాళ్ళ చాట్ లో ఆన్సర్ పెట్టమని చెప్తాను నేను ఆ చాట్ లో ఆన్సర్ ఇక్కడ మొబైల్ లో చూసుకుంటాను మొబైల్ లో ఇంకొక అకౌంట్ ఓపెన్ చేస్తాను హలో
యాక్చువల్లీ ఆన్ వాళ్ళు దే ఆర్ నాట్ కమింగ్ ఫార్వర్డ్ అని భవానీ మేడం రీడ్ అవుట్ చేయమన్నాం సార్
సార్ క్వశ్చన్స్ అనట్లేదు పద్మశ్రీ సార్ మధ్యలో అడిగిన వాటికి వాళ్ళ ఆన్సర్స్
ఆన్సర్స్ చాట్ చేయాలి
చాట్ లో పెట్టమంటున్నారు సార్
ఓకే
మనం చెప్దాం సార్ అనౌన్స్ చేద్దాం
ఆ సోమేష్ ఐ థింక్ యు కెన్ స్టార్ట్
సో వెల్కమ్ టు స్పెషల్ వెబినార్ లెక్చర్ సిరీస్ ఆఫ్ డే 2 ఆల్ ద పార్టిసిపెంట్స్ అండ్ ఆల్ ద డిగ్నిటరీస్ అండ్ esteemed professors and other colleagues welcome to special webinar lecture series and today's speakers are professor D. Ashok sir and P. Srinivas sir welcome sir and also all the participants are welcome to the second day webinar series now the welcome to Lilavat madam for the give the welcome address to the participants
thank you someshwar
somesh change the slide
unnani andi unnani andi welcome kada
next
obba idu oka wow baundi so thank you someshwar I think and padmasri also for this slide very good morning to everyone I extend welcome to all for the day 2 of the special webinar and lecture series so as mentioned earlier this webinar is aimed at one to engage the students in this pandemic then students will get an opportunity to hear the senior most professors then to refresh the students in core topics so that it helps them in cracking the competitive exams so this is the main aim in conducting this webinar and lecture series so just now they removed the first slide otherwise those who were not there yesterday also they can see the program actually that was there on the first slide that Padmasri represented very nicely where all the theme of the four lectures that is covered on the slide. On the day one, we are done with Professor Veera Reddy sir and Vittal sir lectures, which are on the group theory and then followed by introduction to Masubhasan. And today we are going to hear Professor D. Ashok sir on stereochemistry and followed by Professor Srinivas sir on quantum chemistry problem approach. Sir, it is great to have two distinguished professors of the Department of Chemistry, Usmania University with us today. Sir, this webinar itself is titled as a special webinar. That is because of the professors, they are special, which are going to address this webinar. So therefore, a special welcome to special teachers for a special webinar. So thank you, sir. Welcome, we welcome, and I request Someshwar to continue.
Thank you, madam. Very brief and brief welcome address. And now I invite Mr. Shriya for introduce to Ashok sir to the audience.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. My name is Shreya, and it's a great honor to introduce the speaker, Professor D. Ashok sir. Sir is a BSR faculty fellow at Department of Chemistry, Usmania University. Sir has a teaching experience of 33 years and research experience of 37 years. Sir research activity is mainly based on green synthesis of heterocyclics, biological activity, and molecular modeling. Sir has supervised 27 PhD students and 5 MPhil supervised. Sir has published nearly 180 papers, and the research papers reviewed are Green Chemistry Letters and Reviews, OBCs, BMCL, MCRs, Green Chemistry Synthetic Communications and Organic Communications, and etc. Sir has been invited for the talk deliveries for more than 120, and the conferences attended are more than 150. Paper presentation in the conferences of abroad are the first international IUPAC conference on green chemistry, Dresden in Germany, 21st International Congress of Heterocyclic Chemistry, Sydney, Australia, 237th American Chemical Society of Conference, Salt Lake City, USA, 23rd International Congress for Heterocyclic Chemistry, Glasgow, UK, Gordon Research Conference on Heterocyclic Chemistry, 24th International Congress for Heterocyclic Chemistry, 2013, Shanghai in China, 6th ICC International Conference, Paris, France, 27th International Congress for Heterocyclic Chemistry, Kyoto, Japan. Sir was the sectional president in the 29th Annual Conference of ICC held at Chandigarh 2010 and sectional president at 38th Annual Conference of ICC held at Jaipur 2019. Sir has organized conferences and symposiums, which are 3 national and 1 international. Awards achieved by the sir are Mother Teresa Award, Healthcare International USA India, and Best Paper Presentation Award by First AP Science Congress. Sir has a fellow of Telangana Academic of Science, and he's a member of many research organizations and professional bodies, such as he's a member of American Chemical Society and a member of International Sir is a life.
Padmasri mute.
Shreyan, unmute cheyandi.
Hello, ma'am. Nenu vinipinchina inta safe maat cheppindi. Ma'am, hello.
Okay, ma'am. You carry on.
Okay, ma'am. Sir is a member of American Chemical Society, member of International Society of Heterocyclic Chemistry. Sir is a life member of Indian Science Congress, Chemical Research Society of India, Indian Chemical Society, Indian Council of Chemists, Indian Society of Chemists and Biologists, and Indian Association of Chemistry Teachers. Sir has an experience in administrative and academic experience. Sir was a registrar of Telangana University, director of the Research Development Consultancy, CELOU, Director of our Directorate of Admissions OU, Joint Director of Director of Academic Audit OU, and Additional Counselor of Examinations at OU, and Coordinator of Chairman of BOSF Forensic Science, and Chairman at the Board of Studies in Chemistry, Mahatma Gandhi. Thank you, sir, for the lecture which is being given by you.
Ashok sir, start. Please start the.
Can Ashok, I share? Oh, okay.
Somesh, stop your PPT. Yeah. Sir will share.
Okay.
Yes, sir, you can share.
Okay, madam.
Yes, sir. You can.
A very good morning to you all. Thank you, Ms. Shreya, for your nice words. Though I may not deserve, thank you very much. At the outset, I thank Head Department of Chemistry, Professor Veerasamaya Garu, Organic Chemistry Section in Charge, Professor Leelavati Garu, and organizers for inviting me to deliver a lecture on stereochemistry to MSc students. It gives me a great pleasure to associate with this webinar. In fact, it is a rare opportunity for me because a retired teacher once again got an opportunity to interact with the students. I thank all the organizers of this webinar. Hearty congratulations to all the organizers for organizing an excellent webinar on special webinar lecture series in chemistry for students. Double congratulations to all the participants because you got an opportunity to interact with the retired teachers, and lectures are at your doorstep. Thank you very much for your interest. And without your active participation, the webinar will not be successful. Therefore, you deserve double congratulations. The topic allotted to me is stereochemistry. Actually, today I'm going to interact with students. Actually, it is very difficult to teach so many topics of stereochemistry in 1 hour. Therefore, I would like to concentrate on frequently asked questions and frequently committed mistakes by the students. For example, today's topic is stereochemistry of an organic compounds, an introduction. How to write title stereochemistry? Because I observed different students are writing in different ways. Now, I request the students, among the 8 titles given, which is correct way of writing stereochemistry just quickly type on your chart the corresponding number. Most of them typed 8. Many answers are 8, or among the answers received, highest number goes to 8. Actually, all the 8 titles on the screen are incorrect. The correct one is shown in red, because stereochemistry is a single letter, single word title. Therefore, in any interview or anywhere, if you write stereochemistry in 2 words, then they can understand the capacity of or about your subject. Therefore, no doubt it is too simple, but it is very, very important. Therefore, whenever you write, you have to write as single word. Today, I'm going to discuss in brief about stereochemistry of organic compounds and introduction. Before knowing some details about stereochemistry, it is worthwhile to know about the scientists who carried out a lot of research in stereochemistry and contributed a lot. Whatever we are studying today is the contribution of many great scientists such as Boyd, Pfizer, Wantoff, Fisher, Prilog, etc. You have to know about the books on stereochemistry. The well-known book written by Professor E.L. Eliel. In addition to Eliel, there are some books on stereochemistry written by Professor D. Naspuri, Professor Kalsi, Professor C.V. Ratnam has written stereochemistry monograph in Telugu for the benefit of Telugu medium students. These are the well-known books on stereochemistry. Then, before knowing in detail about stereochemistry, we have to know the definition. Stereochemistry is a branch of chemistry which deals with spatial arrangement of groups in molecules. It deals with spatial arrangement. Therefore, you have to know about spatial arrangement. If you take your right hand and left hand, both the hands are having same number of fingers, same type of fingers, but their arrangement in space is different. For left hand, big finger is left side. For right hand, big finger is right side. Or you can see these two molecules. In one case, H is left side. In another case, H is right side. Like this, difference is there. This is about the spatial arrangement. I would like to give some more examples, simple examples to understand spatial arrangement. Cis-2-butene, trans-2-butene differ in spatial arrangement. In cis-2-butene, 2 methyl groups are same side of the double bond. In trans-2-butene, they are opposite sides. Like this, these two differ in spatial arrangement. Bottom 2 more molecules are there. In first one, OH is right side. In second one, OH is left side. Like this, these two differ in spatial arrangement. In stereochemistry, we are going to come across mainly about spatial arrangement. Now see these two examples. These two are superimposable, identical, having same spatial arrangement. Because you have to know clearly where spatial arrangement is different, where spatial arrangement is the same. Now, one more example. Here two structures are given. These two structures look like different, but these two are also superimposable, identical, because just if you rotate second molecule by 180 degrees and if you place on first one, you get superimposability, you get identical. Therefore, in these two examples, spatial arrangement is the same. Like this, you have to know about spatial arrangement. And before studying some more details, the most important is, why should we study about stereochemistry? Because if you know why we have to study stereochemistry, then it will be interesting to you. Then you will study more about it. You can know more details about it. Therefore, you have to know why should we study about stereochemistry. And here I would like to pose one more question. What happens if you don't study stereochemistry? That means something will happen if you don't study stereochemistry. Therefore, compulsory one has to study stereochemistry, especially all science students must know about stereochemistry. To know answer for this question, we have to know importance of stereochemistry. To explain importance of stereochemistry, I would like to give one example. Glucose as an example. You know, glucose exists in two enantiomeric forms, D plus glucose and L minus glucose. Both are having same molecular formula, same structure, but difference in these two is spatial arrangement. That means these two differ in stereochemistry. And about these two, first one, D plus glucose, is very, very useful because for maintenance of life, every day, for the growth of our body, every day we consume D plus glucose in large quantities. It is available in rice, available in fruits, vegetables, etc. Therefore, every day we consume large quantities of D plus glucose. Without consuming D plus glucose, we cannot survive. Or we may consume starch, which by hydrolysis gives D plus glucose. Then about L minus glucose. L minus glucose is a poison. If we consume small quantities of L minus glucose, all the biological reactions in the body will be stopped. Which stops biological reactions is a poison. Now see the difference between D plus glucose and L minus glucose. D plus glucose is highly useful, which is very much required for energy purpose, without which we cannot survive. Whereas L minus glucose is a poison. Both are having same molecular formula. Both are having same structure. But both differ in spatial arrangement. That means both differ in stereochemistry. Because of difference in stereochemistry, one is highly useful compound, another is a highly harmful compound. Why? Because human body is such that which can only metabolize B plus glucose, but not minus glucose. In place of B plus glucose, if you consume small quantities of minus glucose also, all the biological reactions in the body will be stopped. This compound which stops biological reactions is a poison. Therefore, with this, what we can understand is, if you don't have knowledge about stereochemistry, spatial arrangement, you cannot distinguish between D plus glucose and L minus glucose, because both are having same molecular formula, same structure. If you don't have knowledge about stereochemistry, you cannot distinguish these two. If you cannot distinguish these two, then in place of B plus glucose, if we consume L minus glucose, see what happens. Therefore, it is very, very essential to know about stereochemistry. Why this difference is there, also you have to know. One enantiomer, say D plus glucose, is very much suitable for the receptor, first figure. Triangle matches with the triangle, rectangle matches with the rectangle, spherical matches with spherical. Another one, say L minus glucose, not matching with the body receptor, then no biological reaction. Biological reactions will be stopped, by which there is no life. Therefore, one has to know about stereochemistry. Here I would like to ask one question. Did you ever verify which glucose you consume? Daily you're consuming, directly or indirectly you're consuming large quantities of glucose for energy purpose to do different activities. But whether you are consuming D plus glucose or L minus glucose? Definitely not L minus glucose, because you have survived. Therefore, here, no need to verify whether the glucose which you consume is plus glucose or minus glucose, because we consume natural glucose. Say we consume rice in which starch is available, which by hydrolysis gives D plus glucose. From fruits we get D plus glucose. Why? Because selectivity is monopoly of nature. Nature selectively synthesizes D plus glucose, never L minus glucose. Therefore, whatever the glucose you consume from natural products is D plus glucose only. L minus glucose is not naturally occurring, but we can synthesize in the laboratory. But as we consume only natural products, no need to verify. Always we are going to consume D plus glucose. because of difference in stereochemistry, there will be difference in taste. D-aspargine and L-aspargine differ in stereochemistry, but D-aspargine is sweet in taste, L-aspargine is tasteless. See the difference? This difference is only because of stereochemistry, difference in stereochemistry. D-leucine and L-leucine are also differ in stereochemistry, but D-leucine is sweet in taste, L-leucine is bitter in taste. This is because of difference in stereochemistry. Yes, limonene is having lemon odor, whereas R-limonene is having orange odor. This difference is also because of difference in stereochemistry. Like this, stereochemistry plays an important role. We use ibuprofen tablets, but it exists in two enantiomeric forms, R and S. But in these two, only one is more effective, acts as a drug, that is S ibuprofen utamol. In these two, what is the difference? Molecular formula is same, structure is same, but difference is in spatial arrangement. It can observe the difference, and these two differ in stereochemistry because of this difference. One is utamol, another is histomer. One is more active than other one. Stereochemistry is associated with almost all the branches of science. Don't think that it is useful only to chemists. It is not only useful to chemists, but it is required for the students of life sciences, physical sciences, earth sciences. Without the knowledge of stereochemistry, it is very difficult to understand earth sciences, physical sciences, life sciences, etc. Therefore, stereochemistry is the very, very important. That means every science student must know about stereochemistry, must have knowledge about stereochemistry. Role of stereochemistry in drugs. 60% of the drugs are optically active chiral. That means majority of the drugs are optically active the chiral. There, the stereochemistry plays an important role. For a molecule to become drug, especially for chiral drug, it must have a specific stereochemistry, which we can understand by lock and key system. The right drug is the key. Which can fit to the receptor lock. To open a lock, a particular lever's containing key is required. A particular lock cannot be opened with any key. A particular lever's arrangement is required. Similarly, to interact with the receptor, to act as a drug, the molecule also a specific stereochemistry is required, like key. Then only it can be able to cure. Even two slightly different keys will fit inside the same lock, but only one will open the lock. Therefore, even slight difference is there in stereochemistry, it cannot act as a drug. Like this, stereochemistry plays an important role. under stereochemistry, they are going to study mainly about stereoisomers. Therefore, briefly, we have to know about stereoisomers. To understand properly about stereoisomers, we have to know about other isomers. Very briefly, I will discuss about the isomers. We have to know what are isomers. Different students give different answers, different definitions to the isomers, but the broad and correct definition is molecules having the same molecular formula, but differ in their properties are called isomers. If molecular formula is same, properties are different, then they are isomers. For example, dimethyl alcohol and methyl ether. Ethyl alcohol and dimethyl ether. These two are having the same molecular formula, but their physical properties, chemical properties are different. Therefore, they are isomers. The isomers are broadly classified into two types, normal isomers and dynamic isomers. Dynamic isomers are readily interconvertible at room temperature on their own without any external assistance. Whereas normal isomers are non-interconvertible at room temperature on their own. And most of the isomers are normal isomers. Both normal isomers and dynamic isomers are further classified into two types. Structural isomers and stereo isomers. Structural isomers are also called as constituent isomers. The isomers having different structures, different IUPAC names, different physical and chemical properties are called as structural isomers. Ethyl alcohol and dimethyl ether are examples of structural isomers. In these two, the bonds or bonding connectivity is different, which are further classified into chain isomers, position isomers, functional isomers, ring chain isomers, etc. You know very well about all this. Therefore, I don't want to go to in detail about this. But just to test your knowledge, I would like to ask one question. Here, two structures are given. They are what type of isomers? A, B, C, D. Quickly type A or B or C or D in your chart. Most of the answers received so far are position isomers. So far, answer received only A, position isomers. Some mentioned as C, and very few D. Lastly, I got answer C, D, and B also. These two are chain isomers, but not position isomers. The A answer is incorrect. D is also incorrect. When position isomers is incorrect, C answer is also incorrect. The correct answer is chain isomers. Only one candidate has given answer B. Hari Babu Boya. And one more also there. There is no name. But very few given B answer, correct answer. The question is very simple, but many didn't answer correctly Therefore, you have to know clearly about these. Though chlorine positions are different, they are not position isomers. They are chain isomers because in first one is 1-chlorobutane. Oh, sorry, 2-chlorobutane, in which 4 carbon atoms are in straight chain. Whereas in second molecule, isobutyl chloride, 4 carbon atoms are not in straight chain, branching is there. As carbon chain is different, they are chain isomers. But not position isomers, even though positions of chlorine atoms different, because for position isomers, chain must be same. The isomers having same carbon chain but differ in position of groups only called as position isomers. Therefore, for position isomers, requirement is carbon chain must be same and position of chlorine atom should also be same. Therefore, here as carbon chain is different, irrespective of position of chlorine atoms, they are chain isomers, but not position isomers, but not both. Never both answer is correct. Then about stereoisomers. The isomers having same structural formula but different spatial arrangement are called as stereoisomers. Here two simple examples are given. One is cis, another is trans. In first one, two hydrogens are same side of the double bond. Two acid groups are same side of the double bond. In second one, two acid groups are opposite sides to that of double bond. Like these two differ in spatial arrangement. Both are having same Markov formula, different properties, therefore isomers. In both, structure is same. Structure means bonding connectivity. Bonding connectivity is same. Bonds are same. Only their spatial arrangement is different. Therefore, these two are stereoisomers, which are further classified into two types, enantiomers and diastereomers. The stereoisomers that have non-superimposable mirror image relationship are called as enantiomers. Your right hand and left hand are examples of enantiomers because which are mirror images but non-superimposable mirror images. Enantiomers exhibit identical physical properties. Melting points will be same. What solubility will be same. They exhibit identical chemical and spectral properties but differ in direction of rotation of plane polarized light, rate of reaction with chiral reagents, that means under chiral environment, and they differ in biological properties. Then diastereomers, stereoisomers that are not mirror images are called as diastereomers. In these two, cis and trans are stereoisomers, but they are not mirror images. As they are not mirror images, they are diastereomers, which differ in physical, chemical, spectral, and biological properties. Now, one more question to the audience. Molecules with the same molecular formula having superimposable relationship are called. Quickly answer. Molecules with same molecular formula and having superimposable mirror image relationship. I got 5-6 answers as homomers, which is correct answer. There is a lot of improvement is there in the answers of audience, because most of them gave correct answer. For example, if you take two benzene molecules which are having superimposable relationship, therefore they are homomers. What about second one? Molecules with the same Markov formula having non-superimposable relationship are called read carefully and try to give correct answer. Molecules with the same molecular formula having non-superimposable relationship are called. Most of the answers are about 15-20 answers are almost the same as mentioned as the enantiomers. All of you read the second statement correctly. Molecules with the same Markov formula having non-superimposable relationship. Most of the students written as enantiomers. But the answer is isomers. Molecules with same Markov formula having non-superimposable relationship. Here it is not written as non-superimposable mirror images. No. For example, if you take ethyl alcohol and dimethyl ether. Ethyl alcohol and dimethyl ether are having same Markov formula. But ethyl alcohol and dimethyl ether are non-superimposable. If you place dimethyl ether on ethyl alcohol, can you get superimposability? No. Or if you take propanoaldehyde and acetone, both are having same Markov formula. But if you place acetone on propanoaldehyde, you cannot see the superimposability. They are not having superimposable relationship. But as they are having same Markov formula, different properties, they are isomers. Therefore, for second statement, answer is the isomers. Molecules with same Markov formula, if they are not superimposable, called as isomers. If they are superimposable, called as homomers. Isomers are broadly classified into two types, stereoisomers and constitutional isomers. If bonding connectivity is different, structural isomers are constitutional isomers, same stereoisomers. And stereoisomers, which are non-superimposable mirror images, which are having non-superimposable mirror image relationship, are called as enantiomers, which are not mirror images at all, which are not non-superimposable mirror images at all, are called as diastereomers. And both enantiomers and diastereomers are further classified into two types, configurational enantiomers and conformational enantiomers. Configurational and conformational. If energy barrier is high, configurational. Energy barrier is low, called as conformational. Energy barrier low means the enantiomers which are readily interconvertible at room temperature on their own are called as conformational enantiomers. The energy required is less than room temperature, therefore it is called as low energy barrier. For example, if you take D-lactic acid, L-lactic acid, they are enantiomers, but for interconversion, room temperature is not sufficient. Therefore, they are high energy barrier enantiomers called as configurational enantiomers. Here, I will give you the examples for both configurational and conformational enantiomers and diastereomers. See, first example, dielectric acid, non-interconvertible at room temperature, therefore, they are configurational enantiomers. Whereas gaussian-butene exists in two enantiomeric forms, which are readily interconvertible at room temperature on their own. Therefore, they are conformational enantiomers. Similarly, diastereomers, which are non-interconvertible at room temperature, configurational diastereomers, whereas gaussian-butene and anti-butane are diastereomers because they are stereoisomers, but not mirror images. Therefore, diastereomers readily interconvertible at room temperature on their own, called as conformational diastereomers. Then, organic compounds are broadly classified into two types: optically inactive, called as a chiral, and optically active, called as chiral. Like this, classified into two types. That means the organic compounds which exhibit optical activity in polarimeter are chiral, which does not exhibit optical activity or a chiral. Optical activity is measured by using polarimeter. If plane power light rotates, if compound rotates plane power light, it is optically active. If it does not rotate plane power light, it is optically inactive. Now see, plane power light before passing sample tube containing the compound and after, it is same, no rotation. Therefore, optically inactive, a chiral. Now see, plane power light is passing through sample tube containing another compound, but observe before passing through sample and after coming out of sample. The plane power light is rotated by the compound. The compound which rotates plane power light is optically active, chiral compound. Like this, some compounds rotate plane power light, some do not. Which rotate plane power light are chiral compounds, optically active compounds. Which do not rotate plane power light are optically inactive compounds, achiral compounds. By polarimeter, we can measure optical rotation, which depends upon the solvent concentration, tube length, etc. Therefore, it is converted into specific rotation. Alpha D is equal to observed optical rotation by concentration into length of the tube. If rotation is right side, dextral rotation designated by small d but not capital D. If rotation towards the left side, it is called as lever rotation designated as small l but not capital L. Now, again, one important question to the students. Just now we say that some organic molecules are optically active, some are optically inactive. Experimentally, we can know which is active, which is inactive by polarimeter. But sometimes we can predict theoretically also. Madam, is it edible?
Yes, sir.
Somebody said in chat that it is not edible.
I think maybe his problem, sir.
Maybe their problem, sir.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Now, question two. Students, what is the essential and sufficient requirement for a molecule to exhibit optical activity? Your answer must be in terms of other than symmetry elements. We can give answer in terms of symmetry elements, that is different, but you give answer in other than symmetry elements. Somebody said that chiral, the question itself is on chiral. What is the essential requirement for molecule, essential and sufficient required for a molecule to be chiral? What is the essential and sufficient requirement for a molecule to be, to exhibit chirality? Is the question. What is required? Essential requirement, sufficient requirement. That must be there, and that much is sufficient. Like this. Somebody written four different groups attached to a carbon. And I received 50, 60 answers. Most of them said four different groups should present around the carbon. Of course, correct answers also there, no doubt. But first we'll go with the majority of the answers. Majority of the students written that four different groups around a carbon is required for a molecule to exhibit the optical activity. And they said that this is the essential and sufficient requirement. Therefore, now I will discuss that answer. Most of the optical active molecules possess asymmetric carbon or carbons, no doubt at all. Many students think that presence of asymmetric carbon is essential and sufficient requirement for a molecule to exhibit optical activity. But it is not true. Those who return answer as four different groups around a carbon is required, please make a note that it is incorrect. But generally, students are under impression that the essential requirement for a molecule to be chiral is presence of four different groups around a carbon. Now see the examples. The first example, optically active molecule having asymmetric carbon, that is four different groups are there around the carbon. Well and good. Take second molecule, middle one. In this, there is no asymmetric carbon. There is no carbon with four different groups, or no four groups at all. Therefore, it is without asymmetric carbons, but it is chiral. Experimentally. See third example, in which two asymmetric carbons are there. Second carbon is an asymmetric carbon. Third carbon is also an asymmetric carbon. Like these two asymmetric carbons are there. In spite of the presence of asymmetric carbons, it is achiral. With this, it is very clear that presence of four different groups around a carbon is not essential and sufficient requirement for a molecule to be chiral. Then you have to know what is essential and sufficient requirement for a molecule to be chiral. Now, the essential and the sufficient requirement for a molecule to be chiral is it should be non-superimposable over its mirror image. Some of the students written this answer in chat. I congratulate all of them for giving correct answer. Therefore, all of you remember that essential and sufficient. This is compulsory, and this much is sufficient. Is that it should be non-superimposable over its mirror image. See the examples. Different examples are given here, which are non-superimposable. Therefore, they are optically active chiral. See other examples also. Above, two alien molecules are there, which are non-superimposable images, optically active chiral, even though there is no asymmetric carbon, chiral carbon. The second, biphenyls example, which are also non-superimposable mirror images. No chiral center, therefore optically active. Therefore, whether chiral center is there or not there is immaterial. If any molecule is non-superimposable over its mirror image, is sufficient to exhibit optical activity, to exhibit chirality, then molecule becomes chiral. In terms of symmetry elements also, we can able to predict theoretically, for a molecule to exhibit optical activity, the following symmetry elements must be absent. Planar symmetry, center of symmetry, and alternating axis symmetry must be absent. Or when alternating axis symmetry is absent, then planar symmetry, center of symmetry will also be absent. Therefore, we can say that if alternating axis symmetry is absent, it is sufficient to exhibit optical activity. And you already know about the symmetry elements. Yesterday also, you attended one lecture on symmetry elements. Therefore, I don't want to go to in detail. And just briefly, definitions are given, which you already know. Then I would like to concentrate briefly on configurational nomenclature. What is meant by configurational nomenclature? The nomenclature which is used to indicate the configuration, that is special arrangement, is called as configurational nomenclature. The IUPAC names indicate about the structure, but not configuration. But to indicate configuration, we have to know about configurational nomenclature. One type of nomenclature used to indicate configuration of different enantiomers, diastereomers, etc., or stereoisomers is DL nomenclature. Then how to assign DL nomenclature? In Fisher projection formula, at the bottommost chiral center, if electronegative group is right side, you have to assign capital D, not small d, capital D configuration. If it is left side, capital L nomenclature. See the examples. In first one, OH is right side electronegative group, D. In second, OH is left side, L. All these are Fisher projection formulae. If more than one chiral centers are there, you have to see bottommost chiral center. For example, glucose having so many electronegative groups and so many chiral centers. But nomenclature is based on, DL nomenclature is based on bottommost chiral center. At bottommost chiral center, OH is right side. At other centers, OH may be left side, that is the material. Like this, so we can assign nomenclature, DL nomenclature. But DL nomenclature suffers with some drawbacks. We cannot assign DL nomenclature to all the stereoisomers. For example, if you take polycyclic molecules, here one polycyclic molecule is given as example in which different chiral centers are there. But for this molecule, it is not possible to write Fisher projection formula. Therefore, not possible to assign DL nomenclature. Another example. There is no electronegative group in first case. In second case, all the four are electronegative groups. If no electronegative group, not possible to give. If all are electronegative groups, not possible to give. Therefore, to assign DL nomenclature, in Fischer-Pacek formula, at bottommost carbon, one electronegative group should be there. But in one case, no electronegative groups at all. In another case, all are electronegative groups. Therefore, for such type of molecules, it is not possible to give, assign DL nomenclature. For molecules having more than one chiral centers, DL nomenclature is not properly applicable because sometimes molecules having different configuration may get the same configurational nomenclature. See these two examples, dibromocinemic acids. There are different dibromocinemic acids having a different configuration. In one case, two BRs are same side. In another case, two BRs, bromines are opposite sides. But configuration nomenclature is based on bottommost chiral center. At bottommost chiral center of Fischer projection formula, in first case, BR is red side, therefore capital D configuration is the nomenclature is assigned. In second one also, electronegative group BR is right side, therefore configuration nomenclature assigned E should D. But they are having different configuration. They differ in configuration. But according to DL nomenclature, they are getting D. Therefore, if anybody asks about the right stereochemical structure of dibromocinemic acid means, then how to write question arises, whether we have to write first structure or second structure, question arises. According to DL nomenclature, both are having the same configuration nomenclature. This is the drawback. As DL nomenclature suffers from different drawbacks, alternatively, another nomenclature was proposed, that is RS nomenclature, in which such type of drawbacks are not there. To assign RS nomenclature, priorities are given to the four different groups present on chiral carbon as 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. We'll take up different examples. When four different groups are not there, then how to assign nomenclature, that is different, we'll discuss separately. First, we'll discuss the first type of examples in which four different groups are there. We have to give 1, 2, 3, 4 priorities to four different groups present on chiral carbon by following Kahn Ingold Prelog sequence rules based on atomic number, atomic weight, etc. These sequence rules you already know, therefore easily you can understand. Therefore, I don't want to discuss in detail about the rules, which are the well-known rules. If atomic number is high, the priority is high. First priority is greater than second priority is greater than third than fourth. If you are unable to give priorities based on atomic numbers, then you have to give based on atomic mass. Like this, you have to proceed. And the cis gets a higher priority over trans, Z gets higher priority over E, R gets more priority over S, RR gets higher priority than RR, RSS gets more priority than RS, RSR. Like this, there are some rules. Accordingly, we can give priorities. If atomic number rule and atomic number rule is exhausted, then only we have to go for atomic mass rule. Like this, we have to give the priorities to the different substrates. There are so many examples available. These are the different examples and increasing order of priorities, etc. Therefore, now we'll take up one example. Let's see how much time is there.
It is actually completed, sir.
Another 5 minutes, I think. We started at 11:10.
11:10.
Okay, 11:10.
12:10. We addressed about 5 minutes. Okay. Okay. I will give one or two examples. For example, first one, OH first PRT, COH second PRT, CH the third PRT, H fourth PRT. And here, to assign RS nomenclature, one rule is that the least PRT group, fourth PRT group, must be away from us. That should be at bottom side, below. In first structure, it is not there. There we have to change its orientation. Orientation can be changed by even number of exchanges. Third and fourth PRT groups are exchanged. Simultaneously, first and second PRT groups are also exchanged, by which above right side orientation we get, in which fourth PRT group is at bottom side. Then start from first PRT group to second PRT group to third PRT group. If clockwise or configuration, anti-clockwise, yes, configuration. Between two above groups, configuration is same, only orientation is different. The orientation is different means the difference is in us in viewing the molecule. Therefore, the first molecule is having R configuration. Like this, so we have to assign configurational nomenclature to different molecules. And sometimes we come across other than Fischer-Prochsky family. In such cases, how to assign configuration? Here, at first carbon, Br is with very dark line, 2R normal dark line. The fourth one must be hydrogen and it must be dotted. Dotted means it is away from us. Therefore, here first, second, third PRT groups are in clockwise order. Therefore, configuration nomenclature at first carbon is R. At third position, also same, first, second, third are in anti-clockwise order, yes. At fifth position, clockwise order are like this, we can give configurational nomenclature. But here we have to see whether hydrogen is with a dark bond or with a dotted line, that you have to check. If it is dotted line away from us, dark line, then we have to reverse the configurational nomenclature. Now see here, at the second carbon in this molecule, methyl group is with a dotted line, means which is away from us. The H is with a dark line. Therefore, first you have to see the first, second, third PRT groups order. Here it is clockwise. But as hydrogen is not away from us, you have to reverse the configuration, configurational nomenclature. Therefore, for clockwise, you are supposed to give R configuration, but here you have to reverse because H is not away from us, not with the dotted line, therefore S configuration. Similarly, at the third position, all the three first, second, third PRT groups are with dark lines. The hydrogen must be with the dotted line, away from us. Therefore, whatever the configuration you get, that you have to retain. Therefore, here anti-clockwise, therefore, yes. See, at the fifth position, order is anti-clockwise order, supposed to be yes. But as methyl group is with the dotted line, hydrogen must be with the dark line. Therefore, not suitable orientation. Therefore, you have to reverse the configuration for this anti-clockwise. Instead of yes, you have to give R. Like this, you have to give configurational nomenclature. And if you take the chair form, here, whichever is pointing towards down is alpha. Alpha is always away from us. Therefore, here hydrogen is pointing towards down. Br is the actual Br is pointing towards up, beta. The equatorial hydrogen is pointing towards down is alpha. Therefore, hydrogen is in alpha. Alpha is always away from us. Then we have to see first, second, third PRT groups order. First, second, third PRT groups order is clockwise. Hydrogen is alpha away from us, correct orientation. Therefore, for this clockwise, we have to give R configurational nomenclature. Like this, so we have to give R without doing exchanges also, we can able to assign configuration nomenclature just by seeing also. For example, first one, the order of priority groups, OH first priority, COH second priority, CSD third priority. Give like this priorities and observe clockwise or anti-clockwise. Here it is anti-clockwise, but hydrogen is at not bottom side, not AFOS, not suitable orientation. Therefore, for clockwise, we are supposed to give, for anti-clockwise, we are supposed to give S configuration, but here, as hydrogen is not away from us, we have to give opposite configuration R. Like this, just by seeing the molecule also without putting pen, we can able to predict which configuration it has. Whether one center is there or two centers are there, n number of centers are there, we can able to know. For example, in second one, NH2 first priority, CS3 second, COH second priority, CS3 third priority, they are in clockwise order, but hydrogen is the right side, not in correct orientation. Therefore, for this clockwise order, instead of R, you have to give S nomenclature. Like this, you can able to predict. This is when four different groups are present. But one or two examples, Dr. Someshwar. When chiral center is not there, then how to assign RS nomenclature? Then also enantiomers are possible. Then also the configuration is possible. Therefore, we have to give configuration nomenclature. For such type of molecules, same sequence rules are applicable, but additionally, their nearer groups are given more priority over far groups. Therefore, from whichever side you see the molecule, the groups which are nearer to you are given more priority over the groups which are far away. This is the main difference between normal and others. For example, if you take these two enantiomers, no chiral center, but they are chiral, optical active, non-soluble mirror images exhibit optical activity. Now see, if you see this molecule from A site, H, dotted H and dark CH3 are towards you. When you are at A, COH is right side to you, H is left side to you. That means these two are written in horizontal with a dark line. And when you are at A, COH and H present on third carbon are far away and which are in vertical fashion. One is above, COH is above and H below. Therefore, COH above, H below. Nearer groups, if they are in vertical, you are right in vertical form with very dark line. The groups far away, they may be vertical or linear, what it may be, that you have to write. But priorities, the nearer groups get higher priority than far groups. The nearer groups are here, COH and H, between these two first and second priorities you have to decide, irrespective of far groups. The COH is first priority group, H is second priority group by following same CIP rules. Then you have to give third and fourth priority groups to far groups. COH gets third priority group, H gets fourth priority group. Then start from first priority group to second priority group to third priority group, a clockwise the R configuration, anti-clockwise S configuration. Like this, so you have to give configurational nomenclature. Now, one more example. Now say you see the bottom example. Now say you are at B place. You are at B. When you are at B, H is above, COH is below. That means these two are in vertical line. And the groups which are far away, COH and H, are in horizontal line, left side COH, right side H. But nearer groups must be given first and second priorities compulsory. Far groups are given third and fourth priority groups. So between nearer groups, COH first priority, H second priority. Between two far groups, COH third priority and H fourth priority. Like this, nearer groups get first and second third priorities, and far groups get third and fourth priorities. Then first, second, third priority groups are in anti-clockwise order, therefore S configuration. Like this, whether you assign configuration nomenclature from A side or B side, it is same. First one is by standing from A side, second is by standing from the B side. Like this, you have to give configuration nomenclature. One more example, biphenyls, enantiomers. Here two phenyl rings are perpendicular to each other because of bulky ortho groups. If you are from A site, NO2COH are in vertical line.
Yes, time is 220.
Yes, and far away groups are in a horizontal line. NO2COH, first and second priority groups, far groups, left side NO2, right side COVET, third and fourth priority groups. Then these are in anti-clockwise, these are in clockwise order. Therefore, configuration nomenclature is R. Like this, you have to assign configurational nomenclature to the molecules having no chiral center. Like this, for any optically active molecule, we can able to give configuration nomenclature. Whereas DL nomenclature suffers from some drawbacks, therefore it is not applicable to all, even though we use the for limited number of compounds, whereas the RS nomenclature is applicable to all the types of chiral molecules with chiral center or without chiral center, etc. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Actually, time is
Yes.
Completed. So
yes, I can understand.
Students are having any doubts, you can ask to directly Ashok sir to mail, and he give the answers to respective questions. So please, Sunaina, you can give the vote of thanks to Ashok sir.
Voice clear and audible, sir.
Yes.
Okay. I take privilege of thanking Professor D. Ashok sir for delivering such a wonderful lecture on stereochemistry of organic compounds. The lecture started with sir explaining about the pioneers who contributed for the development of stereochemistry. Sir also gave us some reference books and also the authors for stereochemistry. Sir explained the definition of stereochemistry along with what is the importance of studying stereochemistry and what happens if we don't study stereochemistry, the biological importance of stereochemistry with the example of D glucose and L minus glucose. Sir also explained the properties that vary depending upon the change in stereochemistry, importance of stereochemistry in all the branches of sciences, and role of stereochemistry in drugs, taking the receptor and drug with the lock and key model. Sir explained briefly the classification of isomers with the examples, with many examples. So I think all the students got the clarification regarding the stereochemistry. Sir explained the configurational nomenclature, DL nomenclature, its merits, demerits along with examples, and also RS nomenclature with many examples. So thank you, sir, for your valuable time and such a wonderful lecture, sir. This is beneficial for many students, and I feel that many students benefited with these, with your lecture. And I also feel that me and along with my classmates are really fortunate to listen your lecture for the second time, sir. That too in the topic of stereochemistry. I thank Department of Chemistry, Head Department of Chemistry, Professor Veerasomaya sir, convener of this program, and also organizers for conducting such a wonderful lecture series for the benefits of the students. And I also see that many such lecture series will be available for students even in the coming days. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much for your nice words.
On the behalf of Department of Chemistry, we are conducting on a web series. So I will give the certificate of appreciation on token of to Department of Chemistry. Thank you, sir. And this, you are giving a wonderful lecture on stereochemistry to
thank you
participant, and I enjoy the lectures. already this talk I learned from stereochemistry from Mirzapur. We are using a match box as a model. I remember now also.
So thank you. Thank
this
you.
Is your specialty of stereochemistry lectures. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I thank head department of chemistry Veerasamy garu and Professor Nilavati garu and all the organizers Someshwara garu and students. Thank you very much, and I thank all the audience for patient hearing. Thank you so much, and for any query you can contact me over phone or you can mail me. Thank you so much. Thank you very much for giving me
thank you very much, sir, for a wonderful lecture and your time.
Yes.
So welcome to Srinivas, sir. Unmute yourself, sir.
Unmute.
Yeah. Now, Mr. Venkatesh, give the introduction. Introduce the speaker today. Second speaker, Professor Srinivas, sir.
Somesh, please share your screen.
Yeah, I will.
Good morning, sir. Welcome, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Venkatesh,
unmute yourself.
Venkatesh.
He's there, right?
Yeah, he's there, madam.
Yeah, I talked to him.
మేడం మీరు పర్మిషన్ ఇవ్వలేదు. ఎస్ మేడం. మేడం. A very good afternoon everyone, and I thank to the HOD of our department, Professor Veerasomaiya sir, and organizers of this webinar, and all my gurus who initiate this program to benefit for the students even this pandemic situations. Now I'm introducing a dynamic professor, Dr. P. Srinivas sir, who had been taught more than 37 years. Professor P. Srinivas sir taught mainly specialized topics of quantum chemistry, biophysical chemistry, and supramolecular chemistry. His area of research is kinetics of redox reactions, polymerization reactions, and conducting polymers. He published more than 30 papers and written 4 books. He is also involved in chemical education programs and written a book entitled Teaching Chemistry and Involving an Innovative Approach. He gave more than 200 guest lectures in and around both Telugu states and motivated many teachers and students. He organized about 15 seminars, conferences, and workshops. He completed one UGC minor research project for 2 years, and 7 students were awarded PhD degrees under his guidance. He is the founder general secretary of Usmania University Chemistry Alumni Association, OUCAA. We are very thankful, sir, for this. And he works as treasurer in Indian Science Congress Association, Hyderabad chapter, ISCAHYD. And he is life member Indian Association of Chemistry Teachers and Indian Science Congress Association and Indian Council of Chemists. This great personality superannuated as professor in chemistry at our department in 2015. Sir will be give a guest lecture on quantum chemistry problems approach. Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for giving this opportunity.
Good
afternoon, friends. Really, in this typical situation, department is doing the great job using technology. And in fact, we always used to say that chemistry is the king of science, and science college is the face of the university, and university is the torchbearer of society. So always chemistry people are pioneers in the entire world. So our people are doing a great job. I congratulate all the organizers, and I also congratulate all the audience. You are hearing the great lectures, and yesterday you heard the group theory from the great man who wrote the book, and today you hear the super fine chemistry, supramal, the stereochemistry by the chemistry powerhouse, Professor Ashok sir. And afterwards, I am going to talk on the quantum mechanics. Generally, physical chemistry means people have the phobia, and especially quantum mechanics means a lot of phobia. And I manage with that from the last 40 years. I assure you, I don't tell any mathematics. I only tell the conclusions of the mathematics, and people are no need to have the phobia about the quantum mechanics. So people today talking the top technologies, that's called the quantum computer, which is based on the qubit. 0, 1 is the bits, 0R1 is called the qubits. And people are talking the quantum communications, which is based on this, the quantum communications are getting developed. And all of you know, the today's world without GPS, impossible to run the world. GPS uses the atomic clocks, which are based on the quantum phenomena. And not only this one, if you apply quantum mechanics or nuclear energy or what you call the diagnostic tools, nuclear tools, and if you apply to the atoms, molecules, you will get the all modern technologies. If you apply quantum mechanics to the light, the quantum optics, which gives you the lasers, and quantum cryptography, quantum communications, quantum computing. So like that, all topmost technologies roots are in the quantum mechanics. Just like 26 alphabets give the entire language, the quantum mechanics basics are found in entire chemistry. So not only that one, in the basic chemistry also, microwave oven in the kitchen too, rotation spectra, IR, vibrational spectra, and physiotherapy doctor uses, electronic spectra, structure of molecules, so NMR, MRI scanning. And in the MRI scanning, recent discovery, I read one paper, in the living system, atomic resolution is reported by the environmental scientists. So that is the order of the day in the NMR chemistry. A inorganic chemistry fellow reproduced the atomic resolution in the living systems using the NMR. So that is the latest advancement of the quantum mechanics or its application in the daily life. So just I'll go to my lecture. So I don't want to go to the early theories, just I want to peripherally start from the quantum theory to the quantum mechanics. So worldwide, there was a saying, after 1901, the entire science books are rewritten after the evolution of the Planck's quantum theory. The Planck's quantum theory, I'll tell only in one word, taking energy, giving energy in the form of radiation is discontinuous. The best example is money transactions. You can give and take money only in terms of India, in terms of cents in the America. Like that, the money transaction is the best example for the quantization of energies. And another specialty of this quantum mechanics people does not realize is the quantum theory of radiation. In the normal radiation, radiation energy is proportional to intensity. Intensity is proportional to the amplitude square. But there is no relation between the energy and frequency or wavelength in the classical theory. So in the Planck's quantum theory, you can see this. E is proportional to nu, and E is equal to nh nu. So n depends, n gives the quantity, nu gives the quality. So increasing the intensity, n will increase. Increasing the frequency, E will increase. So this is the nature of radiation. This is the quantity of radiation. Thus, both are related to the energy. And this is the Planck's quantum expression, and which won the Nobel Prize. And in fact, for historical reason, the Planck was asked to improve the efficiency of the tungsten lamp. And he was a thermodynamic scientist. He was doing the research in thermodynamics. He was having the two equations. Entropy is equal to function of V by E, and entropy is equal to function of V by nu. At one place there is a E, at one place there is a nu. So these two are at same place, therefore they should be proportional. And this idea clicked him to Nobel Prize and clicked him to change the world. So Planck predicted the quantum theory. If you see the history of science, I gave only all the Nobel lectures or Nobel topics. Whoever proposed the gate theory, they got the Nobel Prize. Whoever experimentally proved also, they got the Nobel Prize. So the Planck's quantum theory is experimentally proved by Einstein, applying it to the photoelectric effect. So you are using the light. Photo means light. You are getting the current. So light is converted to the current. So you are using the h nu light that is spent in excitating the electron. This and remaining is a kinetic energy. This simple equation won the Nobel Prize for Einstein to explain the photoelectric effect, how the light is converting into the radiation. When light strike the metals, electrons are ejected. So the light and electrons are interacting. It is a collision phenomena. And Einstein added one more word to the Planck. Planck only said absorption emission is discontinuous, but what Einstein said is it is a stream of photons with velocity c. Radiation is regarded as a stream of photons. It also moves as a stream of photons, not the train of waves. Wave means train of waves, continuous. For particle means discontinuous. It is a stream of photons. This is the Einstein's theory. And photoelectric effect, if you convert a light into current, it is a photoelectric effect. Reverse of this is just theoretically, if you imagine, you use the current, you produce the light. Example, classical example, first Nobel Prize in physics is the X-rays. In the X-ray production, reverse photoelectric effect, you are using the current, you are producing the radiation. So if you combine these two, this is a working principle of television. It was there earlier in the school books. So how the fundamental concepts are materialized, people should aware at this time. So converting light into current and current into light, these two principles are played reversibly in the transmission of and receiving the television signals. So my intention is to tell you how these fundamental concepts are reaching the common man. So another important consequence of quantum theory is we know specific heats are 3/2 RT or 5/2 RT. But when T is zero, it is not zero. So, but actually experimentally, when temperature is becoming zero, the specific heats are zero. To explain that, the quantum mechanics is applied by Einstein, and he proved that the specific heats are zero at absolute zero. That is the one success of the another quantum mechanics achievement. And first time the quantum mechanics entered into the chemistry is the origin of spectral lines. So Bohr says that electron revolves around the nucleus in the stationary state. So when electron goes from one stationary state to other stationary state, the difference of energy is given as a line. So the line spectrum of hydrogen atom is explained by Bohr using the idea of quantum mechanics. But he don't have the base what made him to propose the stationary states. And that was the background. So MVR is equal to NH/2. Angular momentum of electron is quantized, is a statement. But there was no logic for him. Only he said that momentum, mass into velocity is a momentum. If it is moving circular, radius is fixed. Therefore, it is angular momentum. The angular momentum is quantized. N is equal to 1. N is equal to like that. Angular momentum is quantized. So for this, there was no logical base. And this logic we'll see in the next slide. So the Planck's quantum theory experimentally proved by two experiments, and another is Compton effect. So X-rays are scattered by the electrons, and the scattered wavelength and initial wavelength, the wavelength difference is only function of the scattered angle. So this is the phenomena of only collisions. It is not depending on the nature of radiation. That means the electron and X-rays are colliding. They are colliding means collision phenomena is a particle phenomena. Therefore, the Compton effect again gives the support for the particle nature of radiation. So wavelength change depends only on the angle and not on the nature of radiation. So this is the another evidence for the particle nature. So now there were two natures, earlier wave nature, diffraction experiments, interference experiments. They are the propagation experiments. When light is traveling, the diffraction interference comes. There it is behaving as a wave. In the photoelectric effect and Compton effect, it is interacting. In the interacting experiments, it is behaving as a wave. So there is no dispute, there is no contradiction. So when light is traveling, behaves as they behave. When light is interacting, behaves as a particle, and this particle nature, wave nature are mutually exclusive. So there should be a clarity. When it is interacting, it is a particle. When it is moving, it is a wave. Just like students are boycotting, they go en masse collectively. But when they are writing exam, they write independently. That means it is an individual phenomena. Particle phenomena is an individual phenomena. When radiation is interacting, behaves as the individual particles. When it is traveling, behaves as a wave. This is the greatest understanding about the dual nature of radiation. So before going to this, I want to tell you that this de Broglie is a French aristocratic person, a royal fellow. They had their own research lab at the home. He's an arts graduate. So how the science develops based on the logic? Universe is made of only two things, part matter and radiation. So Planck's theory gives the dual nature to the radiation. E is equal to h nu. Nu is the wave energy of the particle. And when radiation exhibits the dual nature, why not matter? Universe does not play the dice. So when radiation behaves like wave, the matter should also behave like dual nature. And he combined the E is equal to h nu and E is equal to mc square. He derived the equation lambda is equal to h by mv. So in fact, an arts fellow cannot write the read the science, but he was given permission to study the science and he derived this equation. But another big problem is, till today we don't understand the dual nature of radiation. But his dual nature of matter he proposed, nobody accepted, and his thesis was referred to the Einstein. And Einstein gone through his thesis and he found one thing: if you combine the lambda is equal to h by mv, and just now I told you the Bohr's equation, angular momentum mer is equal to nh by 2 pi. So if you combine these two, you derive an equation n lambda is equal to 2 pi r. 2 pi r is the circumference of the stationary orbit. This is multiples of lambda. So Bohr's theory also explained using the de Broglie equation. His thesis was recommended, in fact, at the age of 34. So he got the Nobel Prize. And why people give the Nobel Prize means they predicted that this is an unusual thing, a matter behaving the dual nature, and that gave the birth to the electron microscope. And without electron microscope, you see that today world, everybody is talking about the nanotechnology. Nanotechnology, you're interacting with nanoparticles, only possible without this electron microscope or scanning tunneling microscope, or without these things, no nanotechnology. So nanotechnology roots are also there in the de Broglie equation. And the electron microscope, 2014, won the Nobel Prize at the cryo-electron microscopy. And this cryo-electron microscopy, last year, they discovered the how the mosquito bites and malaria is entering into the body is mapped atom level. So this is the order of the day in the science. The cryo-electron microscopy mapped the malaria in the atom level. So nothing is far away from the man today, and all those roots are there in the quantum mechanics. So these are the microscopes, scanning electron microscope, TEM, and these are the original microscopes. And one more, this de Broglie got the Nobel Prize because for proposing the great concept. So this wave nature of electrons is proved in the diffraction experiment. The diffraction is the wave nature. So when X-rays are diffracted, they give the patterns. When they extracted the electrons also, they give the similar patterns. From the equation n lambda is equal to 2d sine theta, they could calculate the wavelength of the electrons, just like the X-ray diffractions. And they also won the Nobel Prize. One surprising thing about this is Davison Germer experiments, they're done along with the G.P. Thompson, who is the son of J.J. Thompson. His son, his father, G.P. Thompson's father got the Nobel Prize saying the electron is a particle. And his son, G.P. Thompson, got the Nobel Prize saying the electron is a wave. And this is the one of the greatest thing in the history of science. Father and son got, there are six people are there, father and son got Nobel Prize. In this, he is the, these parents are, these father and son are for the same phenomena, that is the unusual thing. So two father and son for the same phenomena got the Nobel Prize. And so now what we got the conclusion is the matter has a dual nature. And to add this confusion, the Heisenberg found that the small particles will have the uncertain nature. Position and momentum, you cannot determine simultaneously and accurately. You can determine simultaneously, but they are not accurate. If you want to determine, they are not accurate. Not only position, momentum, energy and time. When electrons are excited from one level to other level, the difference of energy is delta E, the time is delta T. So any two conjugate properties can have determined simultaneously. Conjugate means position changes when velocity is changing. So like that, the position, momentum are conjugate properties. Similarly, energy and time are conjugate properties. We cannot determine the two conjugate properties simultaneously. Just I'll give only one reason. So if you want to determine position exactly, the size of atoms are angstroms. So to see the angstrom size, you use the angstrom wavelength light, X-rays. So instead of locating the electron, if you use the X-rays, the electrons are disturbed by the X-rays and their momentum, their position is changed. So you located the electron perfectly, but in the process of locating, you are disturbing its position, its velocity. Therefore, you cannot determine the second thing correctly. So it is an inherent limitation of the nature, not the limitation of the technology. So now we have come to the conclusion that the atomic dimension particles will exhibit the two things, dual nature and probable nature. So for this kind of particles, a new mechanics is developed. That mechanics is the quantum mechanics. So Schrodinger, what he made is, for this kind of particles, he took the classical wave equation and he added the de Broglie lambda is equal to h by mv. He derived the equation. This is called the equation for the dual nature of particles. This is called the basics of quantum mechanics, Schrodinger wave equation. Schrodinger wave equation is nothing unusual, simple classical equation plus lambda is equal to h by mv. He introduced the dual nature into the classical wave equation. You got the quantum mechanics. So the Schrodinger wave equation will explain the motion of particle of mass m in the potential energy V. So this Schrodinger wave equation can be derived from the postulates also, because why we have to go to the postulates? In the quantum mechanics, we are describing the phenomenon of atomic dimension particles. We can't see them, we can't interact them, we can't observe them, follow them. Therefore, we should make some assumptions. So there are the five postulates. I'll just only go through that, but I'll briefly explain this. The five postulates are, first one is regarding the state of the system. A state is described by the wave function psi. And next, properties of the system. A system is there just like hydrogen atom, its properties. Next, determination of properties. The properties are determined using the eigenfunction. Suppose if you cannot determine this third postulate, you have to, when you can't determine, when we don't know exactly, we go to the average. That average is the fourth postulate. And suppose if the properties are changing with time, that is the fifth postulate. A system, its properties, third determination, if you cannot determine average properties, and suppose property is changing with time, that is the fifth postulate. So the example of this fifth postulate, how the properties will change with time. Suppose light is falling on the system, electrons are excited, going into the higher levels. How the electrons are entering into the higher levels, the fundamental phenomena in the spectroscopy can be determined using this fifth postulate or the time-dependent Schrodinger wave equation. So the properties are changing with time in the photochemistry and in the spectroscopy. The rate of entry of electrons into the various states can be determined using the time-dependent, the five postulate. This is the ultimate time-dependent Schrodinger equation. This minus h square by 8 plus square m del square plus v, this is called the Hamiltonian operator. So this is write the operator square root or d by dx. It has no value, only it is a set of instructions. Suppose if you write the number 2, means there are the two articles, something. But if you write the square root, it won't tell you anything. It is only the instruction. So like that, operators are symbols for the mathematical instructions. And the just like number algebra, we can also have the operator algebra. Algebra means addition, subtraction, multiplication is called algebra. In fact, from this quantum mechanics, mathematics, I learned the basic definitions. Operator is a symbol for mathematical procedure. Algebra is the addition, subtraction, multiplication is called the algebra. And similarly, like numbers, we can also add, subtract, and multiply the operators. So the multiplication of operators is important in the quantum mechanics. Commutator, A into B is equal to B into A. If you change the sequence of multiplication, the value is not affected. It is called commute. But in the number algebra, 3 into 4 is equal to 4 into 3. But in the quantum mechanics, it is not always true. Suppose if it is true, then one advantage is there, one consequence is there. If alpha into beta is equal to beta into alpha, those two properties can be determined simultaneously. Example, alpha is equal to position, beta is equal to momentum. Alpha beta is not equal to beta alpha because you cannot determine them simultaneously. So like that, if two operators are commute, the operators, the properties represented by them can be determined simultaneously. If they are not commute, you cannot determine those two properties. That is the use of this commutation operators in the quantum mechanics. So there are some mathematical things are there along this. So I can only tell you in this popular lecture only the definition, because all these kinds of things are asking in the entrance examination. So if I go only commutation operators will take the 1 hour, therefore I'm not touching that, please. Linear operator. So apply operator and sum of two functions is equal to applying operator and two functions separately. And this it is called the linear operator. Next is the Hermitian operator. In fact, one more, we also use the Hermitian operator. That is also important in the quantum mechanics. I think I'll tell that. Eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. So in the third part state, you're applying operator and a function. You're applying operator and a function, you get back your function multiplied by some constant. This constant is called the eigenvalue and this constant is called the physical property. So this is the one essentially used in the quantum mechanics. In the normal mechanics, momentum, mass into velocity. But in the quantum mechanics, you apply the momentum operator on wave function, you get the momentum into wave function back. So in this way, the quantum mechanics differ. The quantum mechanics way of operating the property is the eigenvalue equations. I told you I don't want to take much examples. So eigenfunction, if you apply operator on that function, you get constant multiplied by same function. Suppose if this is not constant, it is not eigenfunction. If this is not the same function, it is not eigenfunction. Suppose the function is changing. Suppose d by dx of sine x is equal to cos x. Therefore, it is not an eigenfunction. Like that, the eigenfunctions are used. Bell-Biot functions. In the quantum mechanics, we also use the Bell-Biot function. A Bell-Biot function is one. The function should be single-valued, continuous, and finite. So we don't use the non-acceptable function. So single-valued means if you plot the psi versus its variables, for each value of variable, there should be only one value. Suppose x is equal to some value. Suppose sine x is equal to 90 is 1. Suppose there is the more than one value for psi, then the psi square is also more than one value. Means that the probabilities are more than one. The probabilities more than one is meaningless. Therefore, the psi should be single valued. And why the psi should be continuous? So when psi is plotted with its coordinates, if psi is discontinuous, discontinuous means their psi is zero. Their psi is zero means psi square is zero. Psi square is zero means there is no particle. The particle is moving. There is no particle, again the particle is appearing. So the real waves are continuous, the real waves does not break. Breaking the wave means there is no continuity, means there the particle is disappearing and appearing. So it is not the real phenomenon. The real phenomena appearing, disappearing will not occur. Therefore the wave function should be continuous. And last one, the psi should be continuous. Why the psi should be continuous means the probability is not infinity. Therefore integral psi square delta must be less than infinity. Therefore the psi should be continuous. These are the three conditions to be accepted as a Bell-Biot function. We use the linear operators. We use the Hermitian operators. We use the Bell-Biot functions. These are the three criteria to use the functions in the quantum mechanics. Linear operators, Hermitian operators, and Bell-Biot functions. And one more, the type of functions is the normalized functions. Their normalized function is the integral of psi square delta is equal to 1. I'll read this one. Integration means summation. Psi square is probability. Summation of probability is equal to 1 is called the normalized. So this is also again important. If I ask the physics teacher, he says that integral of psi square delta is equal to 1 called normalization. But as a chemistry fellow, as a least mathematics fellow, I say that integration is summation. Psi square is probability. If you sum the total probability from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to a, the probability is 1. Myself registering in the on the earth. Therefore, the probability of finding me on the earth, x is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, y is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, z is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, the probability of finding me is 1. So like that, making the total probability is equal to 1 is called the normalization. Coming to the next type of functions, integral of psi I psi j d tau is equal to 1. Their integral product of two functions is 1 normalization. Integral product of two different functions is 0. Their same function, here the functions are different. If two functions are different, the product is 0. The product is 0 means the reverse is the two functions are different. So example I'll give you in chemistry, Px, Py, they don't overlap. They are orthogonal functions. sp3 hybridization, 4 sp3 hybrids. How do you get the 4 sp3? 1 s orbital, 3 p orbitals, we combine. We are combining the 4 orbitals. We are supposed to get the 4 hybrid orbitals. For that, we use this condition. The 4 orbitals should be non-overlapping orbitals, because when 4 atomic orbitals combine, you get the 4 molecular hybridized orbitals. The 4 hybridized orbitals should not overlap. And based on that condition, we get the 109. sp2 means 120, sp means 180. Just, you know, total is 360, sp means 180, sp2 is 360 divided by 3, 120. But 360 divided by 4 is 90, simple mathematics. But if you use the quantum mechanics hybridization formula, you get 109. So the mathematics actually predicts and experimentally observed. So that is the greatness of this quantum mechanics mass. Next, I told you Hermitian operator. So I only tell the importance of this. Integral of f a operator g is equal to integral of g a f. So there is an operator a, left side, right side interchanging, then the value will not change. That is called the Hermitian operator. If you interchange the functions about this operator, left and right, g f, the value is not changed. Then this operator is called the Hermitian operator. And what is the use of this Hermitian operator? Why we use only Hermitian operator? So if the operator is a Hermitian operator, the eigenvalue is a real, because all of you know square root of minus 1 I. Most of the times we come across I. So I is real. Therefore, if you want the actual value, that we cannot have the I. To eliminate the I, we want to use the operators which will get only the real values. So the Hermitian operator ensures the real value for the physical property. Hermitian operator ensures the real value to the physical property. That is the purpose of using the Hermitian operator. Sorry. Now, just we came from quantum theory to quantum mechanics, Schrodinger wave equation. Just I wanted to again restart the quantum mechanics. Mechanics deals with the motion of the particles. Motion means a particle of mass m moving with velocity. So motion involves the two things, a particle with a mass m, velocity v, that's called the motion. So normal mass, normal velocity is what we experience, is explained by the Newtonian mechanics. Suppose the mass is small, we know just now they exhibit the dual nature, they exhibit the probable nature. So probable nature and dual nature particles are not explained by the Newtonian mechanics. For that, the quantum mechanics is developed. But if you again go to the any velocity, the quantum mechanics will not explain. So any mass particle, normal velocity, we can apply quantum mechanics. But any mass with any velocity is called the relativistic quantum mechanics. Normal velocity or velocity of light, normal mass or atomic mass, any mass, any velocity mechanics are explained by the relativistic mechanics. It is only applied only up to hydrogen atom. The future generation, my dear students, my dear colleagues, there is a Nobel Prize waiting for this phenomena to apply generally to find the absolute theory of relativistic quantum mechanics. That is a future mechanics or future theoretical chemistry topic. So this is regarding the mechanics. So mechanics deals with motion, but motions are translational motion, changing the place, rotational motion, vibrational motion. So the Schrodinger wave equation can be written in the Cartesian coordinates by the Schrodinger, but you can also write this in the spherical polar coordinates. Then we are going to the rotational motion or hydrogen atom. So substituting the Cartesian coordinates in terms of spherical polar coordinates, you can change this because I removed all the mathematics. So this is the Schrodinger wave equation in spherical polar coordinates. And just I want to tell you, people don't understand dou square psi by dou x square. Psi is amplitude. Dou psi by dou x is the slope. Dou square psi by dou x square is the curvature of curve. So this is a curvature of curve depends on the E minus V. E is total energy, V is potential energy, so kinetic energy. So curvature of curve. Wave means the slope continuously changes. That is, the curvature changes. The curvature of the wave depends on the kinetic energy of the particle. That can be understood from the Schrodinger wave equation. So dou square psi by dou x square is giving you the curvature of curve. That is how the slope of the curve, how the slope of the wave is changing in the wave given by this dou square psi by dou x square. That is the fundamental term in the Schrodinger wave equation. This I am telling you with respect to the BSc students. My dear MPSC people very much knows these things, but for biology people, what is the dou square psi by dou x square means? It is the curvature of curve. How the slope is changing, change of slope is given by the dou square psi by dou x square. So if you apply to the translation motion in one dimension, the three kinds of motion, translation motion is the simplest. In that one dimension is the simplest. So if you apply that simplest case, V is equal to zero, you get energy is equal to n square square by 8 ma square. And in this, n is a quantum number, energy is proportional to n and not continuous. Classical energy, kinetic energy is half ma square. Kinetic energy is directly proportional to mass, kinetic energy is directly proportional to velocity. So velocity changes, ke changes, m changes, ke changes, and these are continuous. But here energy is not continuous. N is equal to 1, 2, 3, and n is also not equal to zero. So why n is not equal to zero? These kinds of questions are asked in the CSR examination. Suppose if n is equal to zero in the wave function, n is zero, this is sine zero. Sine zero means this is zero, means psi is zero. Psi is zero means psi square is zero, means there is no particle. So n is equal to zero is called trivial solution. If n is equal to zero, there is no particle inside the box. Therefore, we have to eliminate the possibility of n is equal to zero. And just I want to tell you a simple example of this application of Schrodinger wave equation for the organic chemistry, the spectra of conjugate molecules. The color of phenolphthalein change or tunnel effect, scanning tunneling microscope are developed using this particle in one dimension box equation. So if you apply to the rotational motion, you'll get the microwave spectra equation, E of rotation, h square by 8 pi square into j into j plus 1. So here in the rotational equation, what we do is the mass is called the moment of inertia. And when particle is rotating on a sphere of radius r, the speed, the dou psi by dou r is 0, means the distance from the nucleus to the electron is fixed. Therefore, the dou psi by dou r is equal to 0. Therefore, all these radial functions are 0, only angular functions will remain. So in this, for the rigid rotator, mass is equal to I, moment of inertia. I mass is I, and this is the Schrodinger wave equation. You get the solution, this PLM X. This is called the associate legendary polynomials. I told you I don't tell the mathematics. Next, vibrational energy. If you apply the Schrodinger wave equation, so here in this case, the rotational motion 360 degrees we can tell. Therefore, we have to use the spherical harmonic oscillator. But here, the simple harmonic motion, the vibration is not requiring the angles. Therefore, here we can use the normal Schrodinger wave equation. Here, the potential, this is a system where the potential energy is not zero. One of the example of the motions where the potential energy is not zero is the vibrational motion. That is the potential energy is half kx square. But here you remember mass is equal to reduced mass. Remember, rigid rotator mass is I. Simple harmonic oscillator, the mass is mu, means when the particles are moving relatively, the mass is reduced mass, Mn M2 by Mn plus M2. Always remember, relative motion, mass is reduced mass. So this is the important thing. One has to remember fundamentals. May not be the physics, may not be the chemistry. Relative motion, the mass is a reduced mass. So EF vibration is equal to N plus half H nu. This is NH nu plus half H nu. So the NH nu is the Planck's equation. NH nu plus half H nu is the, this is the quantum theory. This is the quantum mechanics. In the quantum theory, E is equal to NH nu. Quantum mechanics, E is equal to NH nu plus half H nu. So in the quantum mechanics, we got the half H nu extra. This half H nu is called when N is equal to zero, zero point energy. So the zero point energy tells us that even at absolute zero, the art, the molecules or atoms are not at rest, they are vibrating at their equilibrium frequency. So one of the important consequences of this vibration spectra is inconsistence with the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. The molecules are vibrating at absolute zero. They are not static at absolute zero. That is equal to half H nu. And this quantum mechanical wave function is called the Hermite polynomial. So next is the simplest example, hydrogen. See, if you apply this to hydrogen, I want to tell you the technical problem. If you want to apply the hydrogen, it is a two particle system. Electron is there, nucleus. Nucleus means proton is there, two particle system. So there are the two kinds of motions are possible. Translation motion means just like take the hydrogen atoms in a beaker, they are moving. That's called the translation motion. Second thing, electron is moving with respect to nucleus. There is chemistry. That is the relative motion of electron. So if you want to apply quantum mechanics to this, you have to separate these two kinds of motions. These are the two fundamental things people may not view when they are discussing the chemistry. So if you take the atom, the internal particles are moving with respect to each other, that is chemistry. Entire particles are moving, that is not chemistry. So to separate this, you have to substitute the Cartesian coordinates in terms of the center of mass and Cartesian coordinates in terms of the spherical polar coordinates. And if you translation motion gives you this equation, the mass is me plus m. So for the translation motion, the mass is the sum, not reduced mass, sum of the two particles. Hydrogen atom is moving. The mass of particle is mass of electron plus mass of nucleus. But coming to the relative motion, the mass is reduced mass. Electron is moving, nucleus is moving with respect to each other. Remember, not two moving, with respect to each other. Relative motion is called with respect to each other. The mass is the reduced mass. And by substituting psi is equal to r theta phi, we can separate this equation into the three parts. The radial equation will give you the energy levels and principal quantum number and size. And the angular functions will give you the shapes of orbitals and geometry of the orbitals. So on separating, we get the, this is a phi equation will give you the m, theta equation will give you the l, r equation will give you the n. So the phi equation says that m is equal to 0 plus or minus 1 plus or minus 2 up to plus or minus l. And the theta equation gives l starts from 0 to up to n minus 1. And n equation, radial equation gives n, the n starts from 1 to n. And n imposes restriction on the n, and total values of l should be only n, because l starts from 0, the highest value of l is n minus 1. And I don't want to go further. The phi equation solution is some function, normalcy constant into n into e to the power plus or minus m phi. The solution is a sin m phi or plus or minus b cos m. This is exponential equation. This is another trigonometric. There are different ways we can use in the mathematics. So one of the important thing is electron is revolving 360 degrees and it comes to the same position, means the value should be same. That is z of phi must be equal to z of phi plus 2 phi, means z of 0 is equal to z of 0 plus 2 phi. So if you apply this condition, we come across that 0 is equal to a sin m 2 phi plus b cos m 2 phi. So sin 0 is 0, therefore know this. So b is equal to, this must be b, means the coefficient must be 1. The cos m2 phi must be 1, means 2m5 must be 1. This is possible only when m is equal to 0, 2 pi, 1. Cos 2 pi is 1. M is equal to plus or minus 1, again, this is 1. So the principle of continuity restricts the when values are 0, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2. The quantization is obtained just because of this principle of continuity. After complete rotation, you are supposed to come to the same place. Therefore, you are supposed to have the only one fixed values. Those values are called as the quantum numbers. Theta equation, this will give the L. Radial equation, this is associated Legendre polynomials. And in the phi equation, we'll give you the energy expression. So by solving, we get the wave functions of hydrogen atom. Just now I told you the angular function yz, radial, r is radial function. And the radial function gives the distribution of electron with respect to nucleus. Angular function gives the geometry of orbitals or shapes of the orbitals. Just my intention is not to show the derivation, but the consequence of the particle in a one-dimensional box solution is I'm not covering. So just now I told you the n is equal to 1 to 3. Delta E, energy difference between the two successive levels, they are not equispaced. So as n increases, the energy levels are, gap is, goes on, increases. That is the one you are supposed to notice. So this is a simple wave function. This is the probability curves. So in the simple wave functions, this is plus, this is minus. So n is equal to 1 means half wave. N is equal to 2 means one wave. So every increase of quantum number, half wave is increasing. So what is the quantization means? The distance is fixed, half wave. Next, you are increasing the half wave. This is becoming total wave. So every increase of one n value, half wavelength is increasing. Because the distance is fixed, the wave has to set in this. Therefore, it cannot have its own values. It has to fix in this. So therefore, 3 halves, 4 halves, 5 halves, 6 halves. So these values are, these curves are having no significance because the position of electron is changing. But the positive value means we can understand. But what is the negative value? That does not indicate about the position. We say in quantum mechanics, the wave function has no physical significance with respect to the locating the electron. But the psi square will give the position of the electrons. So here in the particle one-dimensional box, the particle probability is maximum in the middle of the box. Suppose you imagine we are moving in the hall from left to right continuously. The probability of finding us every place from left to right is same. But in this, the probability is more in the middle, zero at the ends. Coming to the second level, the probability is zero in the middle and maximum at 1/4, 3/4. So the quantum mechanical phenomena is completely different. We cannot imagine. So that's the reason people are afraid of quantum mechanics. People are having the phobia. So because we cannot imagine that when the particle is moving from here to here, it spends maximum time in the middle of the box and spends minimum it out. Because we don't see, therefore, we cannot understand that one. That is the biggest problem with the quantum mechanics. So as n increases, what happens is this peak comes very close and the probability is almost same. So for large values of n, the quantum mechanical result is identical to the classical result. You can ask me, sir, just now I told you the kinetic energy is equal to half mv square. In the half mv square, the particles are, in the n value are millions, 10 to the power of 10. Under those conditions, these packs are, these peaks are very close. The, when the peaks are very close, there is no question of this wave phenomena. It appears continuous. That is a classical phenomena. Therefore, when n increases, high. When length of the box increases, very high. When length of the box L increases, delta E decreases. When M increases, delta E decreases. So for large values of N, for large values of M, for large values of L, quantum mechanical result is identical to classical result. That's the reason I told you the quantum mechanics is applicable to any kind of mass, any kind of length, but not any kind of velocity. So this is important. This is called the Bohr's correspondence principle. So inorganic people say that phenolphthalein exhibits a pink color in basic medium and colorless in acidic medium. Organic people say that in the basic medium, the conjugation is more, and acid medium conjugation is less. But when the conjugation is increasing, the electron moving length is increasing. The L is increasing. L is increasing, delta E is decreasing. Delta E is decreasing, energy gap decreases. Means the molecule absorbs in the visible region and it absorbs. And people also might understand very well with this increasing the conjugation. Means length of the conjugate molecule is increasing, L is increasing, delta E is decreasing, energy decreases or the excitation. The energy gap between the two levels decreases when L increases, that is the conjugation is increases. The quantum mechanical explanation for the increase of conjugation, decrease of energy comes from the particle in a one-dimensional box Schrodinger equation. I also want to tell you that this is the one equation which explains the nano properties. Nanotechnology means nano-sized particles are atoms and molecules being demonstrated. The atom technology, molecular technology, because the nanotechnology is based on different concept, size-based technology. Size is changing, property changing. Smaller size particles, red color, blue. Smaller size particles are blue. Bigger size particles are red. That's the quantum dots of gold particle we see. So M is changing, L is changing, the energy gap changes, the observed wavelength changes, and that we see in the peacock feathers, butterfly wings, the color changes due to the nanostructures, and due to the nanostructures, sizes changes, observed wavelength changes, the colors also changes. The roots of nanotechnology also there in the Schrodinger wave equation. So particle in a three-dimensional box, I want to tell you only one thing. So particle in a three-dimensional box, if the three sizes are same, this is called the cubical box. When A is equal to B is equal to, say, that exhibit the symmetricity. When the box exhibits the symmetricity, there is a degeneracy. So always remember, the energy levels of benzene, the energy levels of cyclohexatriene are not same. For benzene, 6 pi electrons, 6 levels, top level, bottom level are non-degenerate, middle 4 levels are doubly degenerate. So whenever there is a degeneracy, there exists a symmetricity. And here also in the particle in one-dimensional box, there is a symmetry, there is a degeneracy. If you break the symmetry, A is not equal to B is not equal to C, the degeneracy is lost. So always remember, in organic chemistry or inorganic chemistry, symmetry leads to the degeneracy. And I'll give you one glaring example. Fundamental teachers also don't know this Zeeman effect. Without magnetic field, one line. In the magnetic field, we get the three lines. How three lines comes? When you apply magnetic field, what happens? People don't know. When you apply magnetic field, the spherically moving electron, the spherical orbital changes to the elliptical orbital. When the symmetricity is changed, the energy levels splits. When the energy level splits, the number of spectral lines are splitting, giving the more lines. So the fundamental thing in quantum mechanics, in chemistry, degeneracy leads to the symmetry leads to the degeneracy. When you break the degeneracy, the symmetry is broken, degeneracy is broken. Please, this is one fundamental thing. So just I'll show you. So in the second level, third level degeneracy, fourth level degeneracy. So again, here there is no degeneracy. So people can ask problems on this degeneracy and energy gaps in the CSR examination. And one more practical example. Size is increasing, lithium, sodium, potassium, energy gap is decreasing. This is the spectral terms, lithium, sodium, energy is decreasing. So chlorine, bromine, lithium chloride, lithium bromide, 4.96, 4.3. So energy, size is increasing, energy is decreasing. Inverse is proportional to size, this is a spectral evidence. So I myself and Professor Rajanayana gave the lecture in the Doordarshan, the quantum mechanics on Sunday. Then I want to tell these kind of evidences, not the mathematics. Therefore, I eliminated the mathematics from my lecture. So one other important thing about the quantum mechanics is, next part, whether I cover or not, I want to tell you this tunnel effect. Energy insufficient, also the particle will cross over the barrier. So I'll pose this question. I don't answer this, but I want questions from you. energy insufficient particle is crossing over the barrier. Examples are the alpha particle in the radioactivity, 5 million electron volts is the energy, 25 million electron volts is the near nucleus, the particle crossover, ammonia inversion, electron transfer at electrodes. And every day we are seeing the sunlight is coming from the sun. Sun is hot sun. How it is coming? Fusion reactions, hydrogen nuclear fusion to form the helium. It is also a tunnel effect phenomena. So the tunnel effect is everywhere in the universe, from the sun to the ammonia inversion to the electron transfer. But energy insufficient, all the particles crossing over. This quantum mechanics equation gives, this is the left side of the barrier, this is the right side of the barrier, but the energy is not sufficient. So the math, the graph shows passing through, but the particle actually goes from here only, but the graph is showing here, and it is steeply false. So the mathematics asked in the CSR exam is, this is the transient probability. Inverse exponentially decreases with the gap, exponentially decreases with the mass, exponentially decreases with the energy difference between the particle and barrier. So these are the three, distance, mass, energy. These three will control. If energy difference is very small, gap is very small, mass is very small, that is electrons, protons, we can expect this tunneling. And based on this tunneling, scanning tunneling microscope, another technology, is discovered along with electron microscope. So 20 years back, I read one book called Physical Chemistry. In that there is a chapter called the Molecular Missions, and other chapter is Molecular Electronics. So 20 years back, I read that. Then I copied this. So one metal atoms wrote on the other metal atoms. These are 20 years back. They made this using the scanning tunneling microscope. So Schrodinger wave equation. Just I want to go to the electronic configurations. So L give you the SPDF. So the SPDF base is, this I took from the oldest book, Glasson book. What is SP? Spectral lines are sharp when electrons are going from S to P, sharp, P to D, principal lines, diffuse lines, fundamental lines. After SPDF, next alphabet is continued, G, H, I. J is not included because J is the rotational contour number. So SPDF is a spectral terms, prefixes, and next alphabet is continued. And one more in this quantum mechanics, Schrodinger wave equation, radial functions. For S orbital, the function is maximum at r is equal to 0. For all this wave functions are 0 at r is equal to 0. Remember that S electron is near the nucleus, the wave function is not 0. These are the questions asked in several times. Which of the functions are not 0 at the r is equal to 0? Only S functions are not 0 at r is equal to 0. And this is the probability. The probability is maximum at 0.53. This is called the radial probability functions. So this is for the 2S. This is for also 2S. So there are the two peaks for the 2S. So again, you see that 2S means there are two peaks. Again, S electron have the two probability. It is having the probability near the nucleus. So the number of nodes are N minus L minus one. Nodes are two kinds. These are called the radial nodes, where the probability is zero. Radial nodes are N minus L minus one. Angular nodes are L. L is equal to zero, S orbital, no nodes. L is equal to 1, P orbital, 1 angular node. D orbital, L is equal to 2, no nodes. F is equal to 3, L is equal to 3, F orbital. But radial nodes are different. I'll show the radial nodes. Just I'll show that picture. So this is a 2P, this is a 3P. 2P means only one angular node. So this is radial node. This is 2P, 3P means difference between 2P and 3P is two umbrellas like. So in between this, this is called the node. This node is called the radial node. Radial node is N minus L minus one, 3 minus 1 minus 1. So 3 minus 2 is 1, 1 radial node in the 3P. So 3P has the one radial node, one angular node. This is one example where the angular nodes is equal to radial nodes is equal to 1. But here there are no radial nodes. People ask questions like this, which of the following has the same number of radial nodes, angular nodes? Just I'll close very short. So in the ABBA principle, I don't want to tell the ABBA principle, but only thing people don't know is the 3S, 4D, 3D, 4S controversy. 4S fills first, 3D fills next. If that is the criteria, whichever filled last should go first. But here the 4S is filled first, 4S is going first. In fact, the 4S is higher than the 3D. There is no doubt in that. because the 4s electron is more penetrating, and 4 electron is more penetrating, it has a more interaction with the inner nucleus inside of the core. Therefore, it fills fast, it is removed fast. It is explained by the self-constant field method equations. Next, Hund's rule, and people knows very well about the understanding of this in the term symbols. So 1s2, 2s2, 2p2, if two are up, Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity lower. Suppose one is up, other is down, plus off, minus off, s is 0, 2s plus 1 is singlet. If two ups, it is a triplet. Triplet is lower than the singlet, because if two electrons are up, they can exchange, is one condition. If two electrons are moving in the same direction, one electron does not screen the other. Suppose the two are moving in the opposite direction, for every rotation, one will screen the other, and people don't know the much facts about the atomic dimension phenomena in the electron. Electron revolves around the nucleus in 1s orbital 10 to the power of 15 times per second. 10 to the power of 15 means you can imagine trillion, 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 trillions. So that much times one electron screens other. Therefore, the energy is higher, because when one electron is screening other, the screening effect will be there. But if both are moving in one direction, they don't screen other. Therefore, two in the same direction, one will not screen the other, two can exchange. That's the reason the two up are lower in energy. This is the reason for the maximum multiplicity. So this is the spin quantum number is plus or minus, all quantum numbers are integers. One of my organic friend, Professor Ram Reddy, used to ask me this. I sent him this. So when electrons are passed through the inhomogeneous field, they'll split. L is equal to 0 is yes, only one electron. It gave the two lines. So one up, one low. L is equal to 0 means only one. So how we are getting two? So this is the proof that L is equal to 0 is S is equal to plus half, minus half. 0 is sum of the plus half, minus half. So again, this is the one mathematically proved by some persons. They won the Nobel Prize. This is the Stern-Gerlach experiments they did in their lab. This is the actual photograph. So plus half, minus half is the experimental quantity for the spin quantum number. And one more polysymmetrical note: two electrons will have the same set of four quantum numbers. If two electrons have the same quantum numbers, the address is same. Two electrons cannot have the same address. But I'll say something you may surprise. This is applicable only to the fermions. Fermions are particles whose spin quantum number is plus half. But this is not applicable to the Fermi bosons. Bosons whose spin quantum number is one, they are called the photons. So bosons is the particle named after S.N. Bose, who is the only one person worked with Albert Einstein to develop the bose-einstein statistics, which won the Nobel Prize in the 2014. Bosons will not follow the Pauli's principle, means at any address you can find any number of particles, and this is experimentally proved by the some scientists. That is called the bosonova, and this bosonova, if you condense the bosons at low temperature, it is called the bose-einstein condensate, and if you explode it, it exploded like a volcano, which won the Nobel Prize. Bose-Einstein condensate is the understate of matter, in that the moving of atoms are called as the atomtronics. Just like in electronics, electron flow is controlled. In the photonics, photon flow is controlled. In the Bose-Einstein condensate, where the Pauli's principle is not following particles, the atom flow is controlled, which is called atomtronics, which is the next another kind of technology of the future technology. So Pauli's principle not following particles are there, and in fact, it is beyond our imagination. It is simultaneously several particles are found at the same place. Approximation methods, I don't want to tell you. Please, anything, I wanted to stop here. My time is over. Thank you. Thank you for the organizers. Thank you for the students for hearing me, because my speech might be little fast, because everybody will have some weakness and something. I have this one of the bad thing. I speak little fast. People may be difficult to grasp me. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Swamish.
Bhavani, thank you, sir. Sir, now Bhavani madam moderate the question asked by the students. Bhavani madam.
Quantum chemistry
problems problems approach in a simple way. Now we invite questions from participants, either please. From faculty or students.
Please welcome.
There is one question from Dr. Rajeshwar.
Yes. Either participants can mute themselves and can ask any questions. And one question seen in the chat, Dr. B. Rajeshwar. His question is, how can you apply to quantum chemistry in the color change in the reaction medium? Sir?
Color is depends on the energy gap.
Yes.
So just now I told you in the phenolphthalene, the gap is more, energy is more, and it may go in the UV region. Color is, gap is less, it will come into the visible light, you see the colors. So the color depends on the energy. Energy depends on the gaps. In fact, the important application of quantum mechanics is in the solid state. The energy gaps is designed. The energy gap, particular energy gap materials are designed. That is an important application, even in the LEDs are everywhere.
Sir, one more question from the same participant, Dr. B. Rajeshwar. In excess alkaline medium, phenolphthalein becomes colorless. Can you explain as per quantum chemistry?
Extreme alkali, it is colorless.
Colorless, he is saying.
I don't know, my concept is conjugation is related to the energy. Energy is related to the color.
Yes.
But how the state of phenolphthalein in high alkaline medium is not known to me. In fact, it's a new thing to me. But I'll try to probe, read it. I'll try to tell you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I'm handing over to the Someshwar.
So much, sir. Now, yeah. Thank you, sir, giving a good explanation on quantum mechanics approach and problem. Now, I invite the Ms. Rahila for vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Rahila, MSc second year student from Department of Chemistry, OU. On behalf of the Department of Chemistry, Osmania University, I consider this as a privilege to extend the vote of thanks for Professor P. Srinivas, sir, for his lecture on quantum chemistry. I feel sir has given us an overall view of quantum chemistry, starting from quantum theory to quantum mechanics. Sir has taken us through a journey with subatomic particles, where we were able to imagine the subatomic particles, including their movement and activities. Several achievements in experiments done by scientists through the tricks in our day-to-daily life were very insightful, sir. Sir has briefly explained all the five postulates of quantum mechanics, including their importance and applications in molecules. You have covered almost all the important topics from quantum mechanics, which were really required for us, sir. We were able to clarify many of our doubts in CSIR point of view. This was very helpful and enlightening lecture on quantum chemistry, sir. Thank you so much for your valuable lecture. Finally, I thank Head Department of Chemistry, Professor P. Veerasomaiah, sir, and the organizing teams for conducting series of lectures, which are being very helpful. I thank all the participants for their active participation and making this a success. I thank everyone for giving me this opportunity to show my gratitude. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Amma. I'm sorry that I did not make it a qualitative. I made it a quantitative. This is my hobby. My intention is always I should target all the audience and not only the particular kind of radiation. Everybody should remember something. Therefore, I wanted to give the more things and fundamental things. In this phenomena, I may not give much clarifications, but I wanted to give the much information. So that's the reason people may not impress, but people will get gained through the lecture. That's my idea. Thank you once again to the department.
Thank you, sir.
All organizers. Thank you.
On behalf of the Department of Chemistry, we will give the appreciation on this webinar.
we cannot provide anything, but we are giving a certificate of appreciation, sir, to present the special webinar series on quantum chemistry and problem. So thank you, sir, for this giving your good explanation on quantum mechanics and as well as some application part of nanometrics so related to the quantum mechanics. How the quantum mechanics is quantum theory converted in quantum mechanics also explained well. So thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Ma'am, Leela ma'am, shall we wind up?
My party is only for welcoming. Rest is under your control.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Even head sir is there. Head sir is also there. He has come. Yes. I saw him in the room. You just...
Sir, would you like to give your remarks, sir?
థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్ సో అంతకంటే ఎక్కువ నేనేం చెప్పలేను మీకు ఐ నో
వెరీ డిఫికల్ట్ టు హ్యావ్ ద ఆడియన్స్ రీసెంట్ ఐ విజిటెడ్ అమెరికా ఐ విజిటెడ్ ద పోర్ట్లాండ్ యూనివర్సిటీ దట్ ప్రొఫెసర్ సేస్ దట్ ఇఫ్ యూ వాంట్ టు టెల్ ఆర్గానిక్ కెమిస్ట్రీ యూ కెన్ హ్యావ్ ద యూ హ్యావ్ టు గో టు ద సినిమా థియేటర్ బట్ ఇఫ్ యూ వాంట్ టెల్ ద ఫిజికల్ కెమిస్ట్రీ యూ హ్యావ్ టు ఇఫ్ యూ ఫైండ్ ద gun also nobody will find there. That was the statement he has given. So this is the order of the day for physical chemistry. But people don't know that without the fundamentals, we cannot build up. It should become part and parcel of the syllabus. So people should understand this one. Not the mathematics, but the consequences or principles are to be communicated. And people may not like hearing. That's the reason I entirely removed the mathematics. Still, I feel that I may not convince all the people. Thank you for giving me the opportunity after this retirement.
We are grateful to you, sir.
Srinivas, sir, you are the encyclopedia in quantum mechanics, I know. So, I have attended your lecture completely. I too don't know some of the things, but today your lecture is really impressive and I hope all the students have enjoyed your lecture. Thank you once again,
thank you.
On behalf of the department. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, one and all. We will end the session here. We'll see you tomorrow at the same time, 10:45 a.m. For another series of lectures. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Madam, Padmasri, ma'am.
Yes.
Please, all the madams and teachers attend the 4 o'clock National Education Policy webinar. Already I posted in our group. Please join us.
He posted in the chat also. Yes. Okay. Thank you so much.